Hello, I'm Mark Hughes. Welcome to Disability Viewpoints. My co-host today will be Joan Willshire. And our big news is we got enhancement metro mobility bill passed in the House and Senate through Senator John Marty, Senator Scott Dibble, Representative Frank Hornstein, head of Transportation Committee, and Representative Kelly Moller authored it. So we'll hear from Representative Kelly Moller and Senator John Marty in a minute. And Joan, who do you have on today?
I've got the Partners in Policymaking graduates, two of them here today, to talk about year 37 of this great program being around in the state of Minnesota. And they're going to talk about their successes and why the program is so wonderful for people to consider joining in and becoming part of that program.
Sounds great. So we'll be right back in just a minute to kick off this edition of Disability Viewpoints. Stay tuned. Welcome back to Disability Viewpoints in our 25th year. With me is Senator John Marty. We're honored to have him on today. And Rep. Kelly Moller is here. And we have what we call really breaking news on this show, because I've been involved down there probably 41 years. And I give away half my age. I'm not 80, but I give away half my age. And for the first time, through Rep. Moller and Senator Marty and Senator Scott Dibble, we got a bill passed, and that is enhancement to metro mobility. So we're going to let Rep. Moller really authored it, and Senator John Marty got it in the Senate, but he wanted an extra person in the Senate, so we asked Senator Scott Dibble, who is not here today, and I'm sorry about that. But we want to start out probably with Rep. Moller so we can explain what we did, how we did it, and why. So, Rep. Moller, if you're there.
Hello, Mark and Joan.
There you are. You're looking great.
So good to see you. Thanks for having me today. And I'm really excited to talk about this bill that we were able to pass into law. And I'll also just give a shout out to Chair Frank Hornstein.
Oh, that's right.
Because he's always been very supportive of this bill when we've heard it in the House. And so by way of background, how I got involved, Mark is my constituent. One of my favorite constituents, by the way.
That cheers me up today, and I need some cheering up.
And has been telling me problems that he's been having with metro mobility really since I was first elected in 2018, and I know Mark has been advocating for a lot longer than that, as he said, Mark. And you aren't the only person who is a constituent who has repeatedly raised concerns about issues with metro mobility. And while this bill won't address every single issue, I'm really excited about what we are able to do with it. So one of the things that Mark, you and others told me about were the service hours being problematic and not being really reflective of what your reality is, just like all Minnesotans, not confined to the service hours that Metro Mobility was currently running. And so we worked together on a bill that would expand the premium on-demand service, the POD service, outside of Metro Mobility's normal working hours. It's a pilot project, and we funded this so that Metro Mobility will have money to contract with the different service providers to provide these out-of-hour services. And it would be from weekdays from 6 a.m. to 10 p.m., on Saturdays from 7 a.m. to 11 p.m., and Sundays from 7 a.m. to 10 p.m. And because it's a pilot, we really want to see how it works and what we can learn from it, what where it works well, if there are pitfalls, what we can do to make this a long-lasting program. But so there'll be some reporting back to see how it's working. And it is set to go on, I think the date was September 1st of this year through December 31st of 2025. So I just checked Metro Mobility's website, and I don't see the specifics on this yet.
Obviously, naturally.
but there is information there on their premium on-demand service and how to get signed up for that. So I would just make sure to be watching there because it doesn't go live until September
1st. I would recommend you call customer service to see what they're going to do, as I would recommend everybody who is listening do. Do you have any questions, Joan?
I think this is fantastic, but what kind of marketing or anything is going to be going on with this? Do you know? In working with Met Council, are they going to get the word out somehow on the program?
I have a feeling those who are butting up against the hours of Metro Mobility will be hearing about this very quickly by word of mouth, but I don't know of any specific outreach other than Metro Mobility posting it and that sort of thing and making people aware of it if they check the website.
Well, I also wanted to have a press conference, and I think that we should take a look at doing that. This is obviously not to badger Metro Mobility, but I'm going to be honest. I've had four pretty major accidents on there and lost two wheelchairs. However, it's how people get to the doctor, to work, and all that. Mm-hmm. So this is to help it, not hurt it, and that's what we're trying to accomplish here.
Well, and how I look at this, it's about being able to live, work, and play.
That's exactly,
I mean,
right.
The hours are exactly, you know, till 10 p.m. That's like a luxury.
Yeah.
For people just, what, you can stay out till 10 p.m.?
You can almost eat dinner. You can almost eat dinner, Yeah, and, well, that's what it is. And Senator Marty did a lot of work in the Senate, and I first want to thank him for what he's done for this, because it wasn't always easy, and Senator Dibble, if he were here, I'd thank him. And, you know, it just, there are so many blockades sometimes to something that is really needed.
What were the challenges of the bill?
Yeah, really needed. And so now we have Plan B.
Yeah.
And that's what's important. Any other questions?
Well, talk about the challenges. I want to hear about some of the challenges of the getting this bill passed because it's unique.
We almost lost it in the House, Kelly and I. And that was in a morning where they're really, really early. And I forget who it was on the Republican side that really challenged it. And because he didn't know of the expense, or he was afraid of the expense. He didn't know, how it was going to work, what we're going to do. And so I actually wasn't going to give up the ghost. I went up to his office and had a meeting. And I said, now, look. This will be a pilot project. We're going to use a cab company that hopefully really works, and I have minivans or something can haul wheelchairs, and we'll make the whole thing work and run it for 2 years. But yeah, we had some challenges, and but we made it. And I'll promise Kelly Moller, I'll be real quiet from now on for a while. Because
Kelly expects it to last a couple minutes, right?
I was really hot and heavy about it, but yeah. And we didn't win the first time we went into the House with it. And so we had to do some fine-tuning, but we finally got it. Kelly Moeller had the patience to put up with me while we went through this, because I wasn't giving up.
And when we had the Senate hearing on the bill, Mark, you were butting against the time, the last ride you could get to. We had to move up in the agenda because of
it. And that's the one major thing that Metro Mobility didn't understand. Government is who pays them. Government is bigger than they are. And I always tell people, I've told a couple of drivers, just because it's 10 to 5, you haven't testified, you better stay there, you're going to lose your turn. And so you got to call dispatch and get a different time. And they don't understand that, you know, that we may be advocating for them to try to get more money or another provider. But all they know is that you weren't on time, you get no-showed, and it's another 2 hours before you get a ride home. And that's what's not fair about it, is it's a business. If I'm buying your service, I am paying. I have the privilege of the time I want to go, when I want to go, and where I want to go. And that's what they don't understand.
And while this will be a big help for the hours.
That's exactly why I said it.
Yeah, but it's still, again, all the other complaints I hear over the years when Metro Mobility is late, and therefore somebody is late to do it, or I've heard from people who they're in a building where they can't be seen by the driver coming to pick them up unless they're outside. Then they're outside in the cold.
It's 10 below,
and they don't have time. And it's the chaos in people's lives.
Right.
I think people who don't rely on Metro Mobility forget the challenges that others face, and that if the service is not reliable and timely and available, it takes away people's freedom to do what they need to do in their lives.
That's exactly.
So I think this will help in one big area of it, but there's still a lot more work to be done.
That's, you bet. And I thank you for what you've done. And we're getting down, bound down about the last 3 minutes of the interview. So I want to ask Joan if she has any questions, and I want to do the final word, and we can talk about anything. I'll do the same thing for Kelly Moller too. So Senator Marty, why don't we begin with you? A final word, any thoughts you may have?
Well, I appreciate your advocacy, and it was a pleasure working with Kelly. And as she said, Frank Hornstein and Scott Dibble, both, they made it happen. They made it get into the transportation funding bill. I'm just pleased that it happened. It's an important step forward, but far from the last step we need.
Yeah, exactly right. And thanks for the work you've done, and I'll see you in 24 or 23, session 23. And Kelly Moller, are you still there?
I am, yeah.
Good.
I'm still here.
Good.
And I'll just, I'll echo what Senator Marty said, and also just highlight for people that what you did, Mark, to advocate for this bill is exactly what other people should do. Feel free to contact your legislators. At the state level, we're a lot more accessible, at least email, phone calls, if you can't make it down there. Than the federal level, and you often will hear back from us. So people should feel free to contact their state representatives and their state senators and let them know if they're having any issues. Doesn't matter what the topic is, any issues that they have concerns about, because your advocacy, Mark, is what made this bill happen. My favorite kind of legislation is to work with a constituent that identifies an issue area and then be able to help that person, and you exemplify how to be a good citizen constituent.
I'm crabby most of the time, but we'll get it done. But anyway, I want to ask both of you, if we do a press conference through here, can we get some participation from you if we bring this out to the media? Because that's the only way to get the word out, I think. And other than that, all I got to say is thank you. But anyway, final thought, Joan, any question?
I look at this as part one. So I'm going to be excited to push you guys to do part two of really get this thing moving and fix what needs to be fixed with metro mobility for people with disabilities.
And it starts out with management, but we'll save that for another day. Anyway, thanks to Rep. Moller and Senator John Marty for taking the time out of their busy schedules to be here today. And we'll be in touch with both of you as we start the press conference. We'd like both of you to be there. And we'll be back with Write More Disability Viewpoints right after this. Thank you.
A lawyer, a teacher, a warehouse worker, a fitness instructor, a software engineer, what do all these people have in common? Well, they are all Minnesotans who are blind, deafblind, or visually impaired, heading to their jobs every day.
State Services for the Blind, or SSB, helps blind, deafblind, and visually impaired Minnesotans create a path to reach their career and employment goals. That might mean learning the skills of living well with vision loss, getting training in technology, developing a resume, finding an open position, or working with an employer to figure out some job accommodations.
At SSB, customers set their career goals, and we provide training and resources to help Minnesotans achieve those goals.
An accountant, a baker, an office manager, a small business owner, a customer service rep, an architect. Blind, deafblind, and visually impaired Minnesotans are hard at work in all these careers and lots more too.
If you have vision loss and are looking for work or looking to advance in your career, just give us a call at 651-539-2300 or visit mnssb.org. State Services for the Blind. Independence, equality, opportunity, achievement.
Thirty-seven years ago, the Minnesota Governor's Council on Developmental Disabilities and the Department of Administration created a groundbreaking advocacy and leadership training program to give people with disabilities and their families the resources and skills to communicate effectively with their elected officials. More than 1,100 self-advocates and persons have graduated in Minnesota, and more than another 29,000 people have gained confidence in advocacy for themselves and others by going through this program. With me today are two fantastic graduates of this program. So exciting. And we're going to talk about this program and how others, too, can perhaps jump in and be a part of it and do some of the great things that you're doing. So we've got Karen Ryan here, and then we've got Sophie Iverson. And so welcome to both of you.
Thank you.
It's exciting because Partners in Policymaking has been around for 37 years.
Yes.
That's just a huge, long program.
Yeah.
Fantastic. So why don't we start off with, tell us, what is Partners in Policymaking? What is that program?
So Partners in Policymaking is a 10-month program designed to teach parents or caregivers mm-hmm. and self-advocates how to have a voice in policy issues, disability policy issues at the local, state, and federal level. Okay. And they do a great job of teaching each cohort. Every year there's a new cohort that goes through the program. The program does a great job of teaching those in the program how to effectively advocate and enact change.
And how did you both get interested in saying, hey, I want to be a part of this?
Well, I was interested originally during my time. I was actually interning for the Minnesota Council on Disability as a public policy intern. And the folks there, one of them being Brittany Wilson and then Trevor Turner, had done the program prior in a different year. And they actually suggested it to me. And so I looked it up, and there was promotion on it at the time as well. And I applied in late June, I want to say, and I totally forgot about it. And then one day in August, I got an email saying I was accepted, and I was like, why not? So I joined. Mm-hmm.
Great. How about you?
I was interested because I have a daughter who's 14, born with Down syndrome, and I found myself really needing to understand what happens next in her life. So I had had this, there's a lot of information out there about how to navigate the school situation and how to kind of work within that. But as we start to look at what she does after school and what kind of rehab and living opportunities and just how to navigate that world to help her have as productive a life as possible, I had no idea. So I took the class in order to help her and others to make their, hopefully help them prepare better for adulthood.
Great, great. How many people are in the class when you started?
There were 40, I believe, roughly, give or take. Yeah.
And it was a mix of people with disabilities, maybe people without disabilities, and parents.
Yep.
Yeah, it was a really great mix. And that was what one thing that helped me a lot was I finally got to meet, I guess that's not the right way to say that, but never had I ever been in a situation before where I could talk to people who actually were self-advocates in the disability community and get their perspective on things. Because, you know, often as a parent, we come at things with our kind of parental mm-hmm. academic view of something. And to really be able to learn, it really opened my eyes to a lot of what we need to fix.
Sure.
Sure.
Now, talk about the process. Did you come in with an issue already, or did you have to select an issue?
In general, the 10-month program every month is focused on a different theme, so it wasn't necessarily mm-hmm. coming in with an issue, but of course everyone in the program had some connection to a disability-related issue that okay. they wanted to be involved in or learn more about. I came in as a self-advocate, and like Karen, I had never really been so involved in a group that had other self-advocates and other parents. So it was really eye-opening to see. And every month we focused on disability history, customized employment, education, meeting with state and federal legislators. Wow. So it was a whole span of disability topics that were for everyone and anyone to learn about.
There were some who came into the class who might have had disability mobility issues. Some had particular preference for really wanting to go deep on housing. A few had particular school change that they wanted. And you certainly learn the tools to help you to articulate that better, but you also just learn broadly some of the more just the breadth of what you need to know in order to even still be good at what you need to advocate for on your own particular issue. So it was really kind of a mix, but it was really interesting to see what people in the group brought as their preference Sure. early on.
Right. So did you go to the Capitol? Did you go to hearings? Did you testify?
Well, in, I think it was like October or one of the later months mm-hmm. of the year, we did a lot of work with Congress people. And mm-hmm. so we got to some folks from Tina Smith's office and Amy Klobuchar's office in mm-hmm. DC actually came to the partners group and talked in person. And we were able to Great. Present to them our selected issues on a federal level. And then in March, we actually went to the state capitol in Minnesota, right. and we all met with our state elected officials and legislators. And so in the fall, it was focused on congressional meeting, and then in the spring or March, it was state officials.
And we also had some county commissioners come in Sure. and speak with us as well, which was a good learning for me, because a lot of times what we don't realize is that so much of what we rely on for funding, even if it's state provided, comes at the county level. Right. So that was so good, because you not only do you have to be able to articulate your issue, but you have to know who to take your issue to. Yeah. And so right. that was really helpful. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Right. Yeah. We had a lot of great practice presenting in front of all of those different audiences, which was very yeah. valuable.
Yeah. That's fantastic, because practicing is the hard part sometimes.
Yeah. Yes.
You know, how are you going to talk to the legislators? Did you have a chance to talk to some of your legislators then?
Yeah.
Was it scary? Did you like it?
It was fun. It was really fun. Uh-huh. I think it made it better that we all went as a group. So mm-hmm. in March when we went all 35, 40 of us, and we were able to kind of split up. And some of us were actually from the same district, so it was more of a group of us being able to meet with our legislators, which mm-hmm. was really fun. And then anyone that... You know, legislators are busy, so right. some of them didn't have availability. So then we would team up with other groups mm-hmm. that were meeting. It's yeah. all very fun.
Yeah. yeah.
So you've got to learn everybody else's yeah. issues then, too.
Yeah. Yeah. And we had Senator Hoffman had a group of us meet with him, and right. he came out of committee so we could chat in his office. And he was very instrumental in a particular issue that many of us in the group had, which was the elimination of the TEFRA fee. Sure. And so that was really amazing to be able to talk with him and have that time, and then to watch as testimony and all of that sure. went through and with the final passing of that bill to eliminate those fees. So it was really neat to see that all come together.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
So did you have specific bills, each one of you, or did you get any issue that became a bill and passed?
Some of us, like Karen, some of us focused on TEFRA. Some were focusing on special education-related bills, so working on non-exclusionary discipline and suspension and expulsion, because the rates for that for people and students with disabilities is much higher. So a lot of people met with their legislators to talk about different ways to do that. And then overall, a big thing last year in the legislative session is just putting funding towards special education. So that was another related disability-related topic that was moved through. And I think the other thing to mention also was that at near the end of the partners class, legislators actually came out to our class, and we got to present in front of them like a mm-hmm. testimony, mm-hmm. which was really mm-hmm. a unique opportunity and definitely not one that I've experienced anywhere else. So that was fun.
Yeah, I think the lesson I took away was we were able to take something that had already made it through sort of the the bowels of the early bill-making process to get to where it was almost complete, where we could watch the final testimony process sure. and understand how that got to the finish line. Mm-hmm. So I think what I took away from that was now when I have my own particular or I see something where we get a group together to mobilize, now I see how that whole journey is. And so it wasn't so much that it was my issue, but it was that I got to watch how an issue went through sure. the process. And yeah. that was really, even though, you know, I follow a lot of news and politics mm-hmm. and paid attention in civics class in high school. Sure. I still didn't fully appreciate how this really works, and this really taught us well how that happened. So
the old civics class, did it help?
You know, it was funny because even in class, I think a lot of us forget that what is a local issue, what is a state issue, and what is a federal issue. You know, so there were times when we were meeting with a federal person and someone in our group may have had a very local issue. And the person in the federal said, well, that's really, I can't do a thing about that. You know what I mean? So you need to bring me something I can do with. Yeah. And that was really good learning, right? You know, that was, and I think we all just need to remember that. But that, in civics class, they teach you that, but you don't really realize how important that is.
Yeah.
And I think too, what we learned as part of that, along with that, is that there are people who don't necessarily, for whatever reason, funding or just some kind of competitive issue. I mean, just getting disability issues to the forefront when there's so many things that our legislators are facing right now. You know, we think that's so important and it should be like the top of everybody's list. And to realize that it's not the top of the list.
A gazillion.
Yeah. You know? Right. And it's like, and certain things we ask for, you know, you say, how do you fund them? And I tend to be one to want to have that answer. You know, I realize that there's, you know, not everything is free and there's a cost to things. And so how do you balance that? And I think that was a really, the time it takes and managing the detractors is also a big learning.
We're about ready to wrap up. So I know that they're looking for the new class. I think it's class 41 coming up here in September or starting to look for individuals. We'll have something up on the screens so people can go to the site and for the application. But in quick response, what would you tell somebody real quick of why they should apply and be a part of this great program?
I personally think you can't get the information anywhere else. And like I've said, I would pay for it if it was offered someplace. I mean, it's just an amazing one place to get a lot of great learning.
Yeah, very unique experience and very much it's well worth it. For sure would pay again to take it again. And us alumni are even talking about stopping in again. Sure. So it's definitely
Well, thanks so much for coming on the show and being my guest. And congratulations on graduating from this great, fantastic program. So we expect to continue to see great things from you guys.
Thank you.
Getting bills passed for the disability community.
Thank you.
Thank you. Our pleasure.
And we'll be right back after these messages.
Well, thanks again for watching Disability Viewpoints. I really appreciate you watching at home. And was a great show. We've put out some information on the new Metro Mobility Enhancement to start September 1st of 2023. We're going to probably follow up at some point with a press conference. We'll get it together and let you know. And Joan, you have any final thoughts?
Well, the two individuals I had, graduates from the Partners in Policymaking program, were absolutely fantastic. It was great to hear what successes they've been having working at the Capitol as well on some legislative issues and just promoting the program in itself because others should learn about it and join in and be a part of that great program.
They should. And again, thanks for watching Disability Viewpoints. And we'll be catching up to you with a press conference coming up real soon and other fun things here. And October 1st will be our 25th anniversary, and I'm very proud of that. But I can't do it myself. There are a lot of talented people behind the scenes and co-anchors here. And most of all, thank you for watching at home. Bye for now.